evening and welcome to the webinar series hosted by Pro Bono Publico. Today, we are going to discuss on a very interesting topic, that is medical negligence. And to talk on that topic, we have with us Mr. Nachiket Jaivan, President of the Bombay City Civil and Sessions Court Bar Association. To introduce to our key speaker, I now welcome Mr. Mihir Govilkar, partner at Govilkar & Associates LLP.
Hello everyone. Thank you, Kinjal, for welcoming everyone. And I welcome everybody once again to the 19th webinar of Pro Bono Publico. Today is the first day of what has been now labeled as Mission Begin Again. And in that same spirit, I have begun shaving again. So that's why the new look. Anyway, I did not like it. But today, as Kinjal said, we have a topic. And topic has been talked about, discussed, and debated about a lot. And there are several judgments, there are several laws, and about what constitutes medical negligence. There is professional misconduct, there is negligence. There is a difference in the two. And to understand this better, it is necessary to go into the case law, because it is going to the actual actions taken by the doctors and whether there was in fact any professional misconduct or any negligence. And to discuss this topic at length, today we have with us Advocate Nachiket Jaivan. He has several decades of experience in this field. And today he is also the president of the Bombay City Civil and Sessions Court Bar Association. So I humbly welcome Advocate Nachiket Jaivan. Welcome, sir.
Thank you.
Sir, I invite you to take the topic ahead, and I'm sure it will be an interesting session. Thank you so much.
Friends, in the first place, I sincerely thank Sri Rajshekhar Govilkar and Sri Mihir Govilkar of Govilkar Associates for giving me this opportunity to address you on this webinar on the topic of medical negligence. Friends, Consumer Protection Act was enacted in the year 1986, and thereafter the people became aware of their rights as consumers. Subsequently, in the year 1991, a complaint was filed by one Mr. B.S. Hegde against Dr. Sudhanshu Bhattacharya, a cardiothoracic surgeon, before the Maharashtra State Commission in Mumbai, for compensation on the ground of negligence. The complainant alleged that although the doctor had recovered charges for post-operative treatment after the bypass surgery, he was not given any post-operative treatment by the doctor. The said complaint was decided by the state commission in favor of the complainant, and compensation was awarded to him. This judgment was given a wide publicity in the media, and thereafter a number of complaints were filed against doctors. Ultimately, the said judgment was set aside by the National Commission by its common judgment in the appeals filed by both the parties. The said judgment in the matter of P.S. Hegde versus Dr. Sudhanshu Bhattacharya has been reported in 1992 Consumer Protection Journal, page 449. However, by the said judgment of Honorable State Commission in the original complaint, the patients became aware of their rights as consumers against the doctors. In the initial stages, the doctors contended that since the service rendered by the doctors was a contract of personal service, as contemplated under the definition of service under Section 210 of Consumer Protection Act 1986, the service rendered by the doctors was beyond the purview of Consumer Protection Act. However, this issue was set at rest by the Honorable Supreme Court in the case of Indian Medical Association versus V.P. Shanta, reported in 1995 Supreme Court Cases, Volume 6, page 65. The Supreme Court in that case made a distinction between a contract of personal service and contract for personal service and held that service rendered by medical professionals was a contract for personal service and as such was not exempted from the definition of service under Consumer Protection Act. In the said judgment, the Honorable Supreme Court has clarified the difference in contract of personal service and contract for personal service as under, and I quote, "It is no doubt true that the relationship between a medical practitioner and a patient carries within it certain degree of mutual confidence and trust, and therefore the services rendered by a medical practitioner can be regarded as services of personal nature. But since there is no relationship of master and servant between the doctor and the patient, the contract between the medical practitioner and his patient cannot be treated as a contract of personal service, but is a contract for services and the service rendered by the medical practitioner to his patient under such a contract is not covered by the exclusionary part of the definition of service as contained in Section 210 of the Act." Unquote. However, the medical services given free of charge are not covered under the provisions of Consumer Protection Act. That is how the doctors came under the purview of Consumer Protection Act. The patients can, of course, sue the doctors for negligence in a civil court. Before Consumer Protection Act 1986 was enacted, people used to approach civil court for redressal of their grievances against the doctors. However, as we know, the procedure followed in civil courts is quite cumbersome. Hence, the provisions of Consumer Protection Act came to the rescue of the patients who had some grievance against the doctors. In this context, it would be relevant to make a reference to a judgment in the matter of Lakshman Balkrishna Joshi versus Trimbak Babu Gorbole and another, reported in AIR 1969 Supreme Court, page 128, wherein the doctor was held to be guilty of negligence and compensation was awarded to the patient. Now, friends, before proceeding to the topic of today's discussion, I would like to briefly state the hierarchy of courts under Consumer Protection Act. The lowest court is District Forum, then State Commission and National Commission. The peculiar jurisdiction of District Forum is Rs. 20 lakhs, of State Commission is Rs. 1 crore, and of National Commission more than Rs. 1 crore. The appeals from the orders of District Forum lie before the State Commission, and appeals and revisions from the orders of State Commission lie before the National Commission. The orders of the National Commission can be challenged before the Supreme Court. Now, on this background, let us come to the topic of medical negligence. Friends, there is a misconception that if there is any mishap during surgery, procedure or treatment, the same is due to the negligence on the part of the doctor. So it is necessary that we must understand what is meant by negligence. Negligence can be defined as an unreasonable conduct. That is, conduct which a reasonable man would avoid on the ground that it involves undue risk or harm to another. In other words, doing something which a reasonable, prudent person would not do, or not doing something which a reasonable, prudent person should do, amounts to negligence. The law imposes on all persons the duty to exercise care, skill, and foresight of a reasonable man or an average person of prudence and confidence. This assumes greater importance in the case of doctors. This aspect has been properly defined in Halsbury's Laws of England as follows, and I quote, "A person who holds himself out as ready to give medical advice or treatment impliedly undertakes that he is possessed of skill and knowledge for the purpose. Such a person, whether he is a registered medical practitioner or not, who is consulted by a patient, owes him certain duties, namely, a duty of care in deciding whether to undertake the case, a duty of care in deciding what treatment to give, a duty of care in his administration of that treatment. A breach of any of these duties will support an action for negligence by the patient." I unquote. All along and till date, the law laid down in Bolam's case, popularly known as Bolam's test, is consistently followed by all the courts all over the world, including Indian courts, as laying down the correct principle of law on the subject of medical negligence. In Bolam versus Fryam Hospital Management Committee, reported in 1957 to All England Reports,
sir,
page 118.
Sir, sorry to interrupt you. There are some comments coming in that the audio is not, it's not easily possible to hear you. Would you be able to increase the volume, sir, please?
Hello, Meer.
Can you speak a bit loudly, sir?
Am I audible?
Yes, sir, but can you just increase your volume a little bit so that there are some people saying that the Hello. Audio is not very good.
Hello. Hello. Sorry, friends. All along and till date, the law laid down in Bolam's case, popularly known as Bolam's test, is consistently followed by all the courts all over the world, including Indian courts, as laying down the correct principle of law on the subject of medical negligence. In Bolam versus Fryam Hospital Management Committee, reported in 1957 to All England Reports, page 118, Justice McNair summed up the law as under, and I quote, "The test is the standard of the ordinary skilled man exercising and professing to have that special skill. A man need not possess the highest expert skill. It is well-established law that it is sufficient if he exercises the ordinary skill of an ordinary competent man exercising that particular art. In the case of a medical man, negligence means failure to act in accordance with the standards of reasonably competent medical men at the time. There may be one or more perfectly proper standards, and if he conforms with one of these proper standards, then he is not negligent. Unquote. Now, the first and foremost thing as far as the doctors are concerned is that the doctor must possess the requisite qualifications and expertise. A doctor must practice the pathy in which he is trained. A doctor having qualifications of one branch should never attempt to treat a patient with a different line of medicine. In short, if a doctor treats a patient beyond his qualifications or expertise, the same would amount to negligence per se. The landmark judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court on this issue is in the matter of Poonam Verma versus Ashwin Patel, reported in 1996 Supreme Court Cases, Volume 4, page 332. In this case, the doctor, who was a homeopath, prescribed allopathic medicines to the patient who approached him with a complaint of fever. Initially, the homeopath treated him for viral fever and subsequently for typhoid with allopathic medicines. The doctor also did not call for any pathological tests before prescribing the medicines. When the condition of the patient deteriorated, he was shifted to a hospital and ultimately the patient died. On this background, it was held that the doctor was negligent and negligent per se because he prescribed allopathic medicines, though he was not qualified to prescribe allopathic medicines. Another important aspect is the reasonable care which a person of prudence and competence should take. This involves proper understanding and analysis of all the relevant medical records and clinical condition of the patient. Before deciding the line of treatment for the patient, the doctor must give a proper thought to the condition of the patient. If the doctor adopts a line of treatment which is not in consonance with the medical reports and the clinical condition of the patient, the same would definitely amount to negligence. As I said earlier, the basic underlying principle is failure to do something which a man of prudence and competence should do, or doing something which a man of prudence and competence would not do, amounts to negligence. But in this context, we must keep in mind that an error of judgment would not amount to negligence. As far as error of judgment on the part of the doctor is concerned, in the case of White House versus Jordan and another, reported in 1981, one All England Reports, page 267, the House of Lords held that an error of judgment could be negligence if it is an error which would not have been made by a reasonably competent professional man acting with ordinary care. Lord Fraser pointed out thus, and I quote, "The true position is that an error of judgment may or may not be negligence. It depends on the nature of error. If it is one that would not have been made by a reasonably competent professional man professing to have the standard and type of skill that the defendant holds himself out as having and acting with ordinary care, then it is negligence. If, on the other hand, it is an error that such a man acting with ordinary care might have made, then it is not negligence." Unquote. The degree of skill and care required by a medical practitioner is so stated by in Halsbury's Laws of England as under, and I quote, "The practitioner must bring to his task a reasonable degree of skill and knowledge and must exercise a reasonable degree of care neither the very highest nor the very low degree of care or competence judged in the light of the particular circumstances of each case is what the law requires. And a person is not liable in negligence because someone else of greater skill and knowledge would have prescribed different treatment or operated in a different way. Nor is he guilty of negligence if he has acted in accordance with a practice accepted as proper by a responsible body of medical men skilled in that particular art, even though a body of adverse opinion also existed among medical men. Unquote. Deviation from the normal practice is not necessarily evidence of negligence. English authors on negligence have prescribed three tests to determine negligence on the part of the doctors. And those tests are as under. One, that there is usual and normal practice, that the doctor has not adopted it, and that the course in fact adopted by the doctor is one which no professional man of ordinary skill would have taken had he been acting with ordinary care. In this context, Lord Denning has held as under. The jury must not therefore find him negligent simply because one of the risks inherent in an operation actually took place, or because in a matter of opinion he made an error of judgment. They should find him guilty when he had fallen short of standard of reasonable medical care when he was deserving sanction. Unquote. Of course, the deviation from normal practice, if based on sound medical principles, would definitely be acceptable. Because if such deviations are not accepted, there would be no scope for inventions. There are a number of procedures and treatments in the medical field which have been invented by reputed doctors, and those procedures are known after the said doctors who invented them. Now, on the background of what I have stated, we can summarize the rights of a consumer by a doctor as follows. A. The doctor must possess the requisite qualifications and expertise to treat the patient. B. The doctor must explain the nature of illness of the patient and the line of treatment being adopted by him to treat the patient and the pros and cons of the said treatment. In the case of medical procedure or surgery, the doctor must obtain informed consent of the patient. The doctor must furnish all the relevant papers and reports to the patient. Now let us understand the duties of the patient. The first and foremost duty of the patient is to disclose to the doctor all the facts relating to the patient's health condition. The patient may feel certain factors as irrelevant. However, the patient should inform all the facts to the doctor and allow the doctor to decide what is relevant and what is irrelevant. The patient should undergo all the tests as may be advised by the doctor and show the reports of the same to the doctor. The patient must follow all the instructions given by the doctor properly. In this connection, I can share my own experience. I had an occasion to handle a case of an anesthetist. The patient was a young girl of 22 years and was suffering from a disorder of jaw. After the girl was admitted to the hospital, the anesthetist examined her before the operation and all the requisite preoperative tests were done. The patient informed the doctors that she had undergone a surgery at another hospital some time back under general anesthesia. When the patient was asked to get the papers relating to the said surgery, she informed the doctors that the said papers were missing. Thereafter, on the basis of her existing reports, she was declared as fit for operation by the anesthetist and other doctors. Then the anesthetist started administering anesthesia during surgery. The patient started giving weird reactions. The anesthetist and the surgeon took all the remedial measures, but the patient did not respond to the said measures, and she went into a state of unconsciousness and ultimately died after a few days. The doctors were confused on account of the said reactions given by the patient. Thereafter, the mother of the patient filed a complaint before the State Commission for compensation, alleging negligence on the part of the doctors. At that stage, doctors made inquiries with other hospitals where she had been previously operated upon and found that she was hypothyroidic, and the previous surgery was performed by the doctors at the said hospitals after controlling her thyroid problem. Ultimately, it was found that her thyroidic status had caused all the problems and her consequent death. This shows that if the patient had revealed her health condition properly to the doctors, she could have been saved. In this case, the State Commission held that the anesthetist was not negligent and the complaint filed by the mother of the patient was dismissed. Now, before proceeding further, I must say that there are a lot of misconceptions in the minds of the people. In every case of failure to achieve the desired results of the treatment or the death of a patient at any stage of treatment, the same cannot be attributed to negligence on the part of the doctor. Another landmark judgment on the point of medical negligence is in the case of Jacob Mathew versus State of Punjab, reported in AIR 2005, Supreme Court, page 3180. In this case, a criminal case was filed against the doctor by the son of the deceased. The doctor filed a petition in the High Court for quashing. However, the said petition was dismissed by the High Court and the matter was carried to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court was pleased to quash the criminal proceedings against the doctor. The Supreme Court, in its judgment, observed as I know, and I quote, "The subject of negligence in the context of medical profession necessarily calls for treatment with a difference. There is a marked tendency to look for a human actor to blame for an untoward event, a tendency that is closely linked with a desire to punish. Things have gone wrong and therefore somebody must be found to answer for it. An empirical study reveals that background to the mishap is frequently far more complex than may generally be assumed. It can be demonstrated that actual blame for the outcome has to be attributed with great caution. For a medical accident or failure, the responsibility may lie with the medical practitioner and equally it may not. The inadequacies of the system, the specific circumstances of the case, the nature of human psychology itself, and sheer chance may have combined to produce a result in which the doctor's contribution is either relatively or completely blameless. The human body and its working is nothing less than a highly complex machine. Coupled with the complexities of medical science, the scope for misimpressions, misgivings, and misplaced allegations against the operator, that is the doctor, cannot be ruled out. One may have notions of best or ideal practice which are different from the reality of how medical practice is carried on or how medical practice or how the doctor functions in real life. The factors of pressing need and limited resources cannot be ruled out from consideration. Dealing with a case of medical negligence needs a deeper understanding of the practical side of medicine. The purpose of holding a professional liable for his act or omission, if negligent, is to make life safer and to eliminate the possibility of recurrence of negligence in future. The human body and medical science both are too complex to be easily understood. To hold in favor of existence of negligence associated with the action or inaction of a medical professional requires an in-depth understanding of the working of a professional, as also the nature of the job and of errors committed by chance, which do not necessarily involve the element of culpability. Unquote. Earlier, I narrated the rights of a consumer who are the doctors, and one of them is that the doctor must obtain informed consent before performing a medical procedure or a surgery on the patient. This is a very important aspect of medical profession. As per the established law, the patient consent should be taken after explaining to the patient elaborately about all the aspects of the surgical procedure and probable and inherent risk in the surgery. And that is the reason why the consent in medical cases has been described as informed consent. The patient has a right to select alternative form of treatment. Consent taken should not be casual or in routine manner. However, an exception is made in the case of emergency. The doctrine of necessity would protect the surgeon who may be constrained to act without patient's consent. Similarly, if the patient is a minor, mentally challenged, or incapacitated by any reason, the consent given by the guardian of the patient is valid consent. The concept of informed consent is largely developed in America and England. In England, it is referred to as real consent, whereas in America, it is called informed consent. In my personal opinion, informed consent assumes greater importance when the patient is in a position to choose the line of treatment out of the various lines of treatments proposed by the doctor. There is one more aspect of consent by the patient for a medical procedure or surgery, and that is implied consent. When a doctor fails to prove that he had obtained informed consent of the patient before procedure of surgery, the doctors usually try to take shelter behind implied consent. From the fact that the patient has got itself admitted in the hospital as directed by the surgeon, after observing the instructions given by the doctors, like fasting for a particular period, etc., it can be inferred that the patient had impliedly consented for the surgery. But it is very difficult for the doctors to prove implied consent. Another important aspect of medical negligence is the liability of the hospital wherein the surgery or procedure is performed by the doctor. It has been held that the hospitals are vicariously liable for the acts of the doctors attached to it. The underlying principle behind holding the hospital vicariously liable is that when a patient goes to the hospital, he goes there on account of the reputation of the hospital, and with the hope that due and proper care will be taken by the hospital authorities. If the hospital fails to discharge their duties through their doctors, being employed on job basis or employed on contract basis, it is hospital which has to justify the acts of commission or omission on behalf of their doctors. This view has been taken by the Supreme Court in Achyutra Haribhau Kodwa versus State of Maharashtra, 1996, Volume 2, Supreme Court Cases, page 634, and Savita Garg versus National Heart Institute, reported in 2004, Volume 8, Supreme Court Cases, page 56. This view has been confirmed by the Supreme Court in its recent judgment in the case of Civil Appeal number 6619 of 2016, Maharaja Agrasen Hospital and others versus Master Rishabh Sharma and others, decided on 16 December 2019. In this case, the Honorable Supreme Court has observed as under, and I quote, "It is well established that a hospital is vicariously liable for the acts of negligence committed by the doctors engaged or empaneled to provide medical care. It is common experience that when the patient goes to a hospital, he goes there on account of the reputation of the hospital and with the hope that due and proper care will be taken by the hospital authorities. If the hospital fails to discharge their duties through their doctors being employed on job basis or employed on contract basis, it is the hospital which has to justify the acts of commission or omission on behalf of their doctors." Now, in every treatment or surgery, there are inherent risks involved. If the patient does not respond to the treatment as desired, or if there is a mishap during surgery, the same can be one of the known complications of the said treatment or surgery. I would like to give you some instances of such known complications or inherent risks. Here we can take an instance of surgery for removal of cataract. Apparently, it appears to be a very simple surgery. The patient returns home within 2 hours of the surgery. But there are several known complications of this simple surgery. I was representing one ophthalmologist to perform the surgery for removal of cataract, but the eyesight of the patient did not improve to the expected level. Hence, the patient filed a complaint before the district forum in Mumbai for compensation, claiming that there was negligence on the part of the doctor in performing the said surgery for removal of cataract. Here, we successfully pointed out to the forum that the muscles in the patient's eye could not properly hold the lens which was implanted, and that resulted in failure to achieve desired level of vision. This contention was accepted by the forum and the complaint was dismissed. In another case of an ophthalmologist whom I was representing, the doctor made a mistake in determining the size of the lens to be implanted, and consequently the patient was required to undergo repeat surgeries to rectify the problem. This was beyond the purview of error of judgment, and the doctor was required to pay compensation to the patient. Another important complication in the field of medicine is disseminated intravascular coagulation, which is known in medical parlance as DIC. This in common parlance means failure of clotting mechanism of blood. This usually occurs in case of women after delivery or after some gynecological procedure. In this case, suddenly the patient starts bleeding, and on account of failure of clotting mechanism, it becomes very difficult for the doctor to stop bleeding. In majority of cases, it proves to be fatal. The sudden onset of bleeding and inability of the doctor to stop bleeding is considered as a negligence on the part of the doctor. However, it is a known complication, and on account of sudden onset of bleeding without warning and the heaviness of bleeding, the doctor is helpless and it results in the death of a patient. Further, there is no way in which a doctor can ascertain in advance whether a patient was likely to go into DIC. I had an occasion to handle a consumer complaint relating to DIC on behalf of a doctor. A lady delivered early in the morning. Thereafter, the patient suddenly started bleeding very heavily. Blood was for transfusion was called for, but before the blood could be transfused, the patient died. Hence, the husband of the patient filed a complaint before the state commission for compensation. The details and particulars of DIC were pointed out before the Honorable State Commission, and particularly the suddenness thereof. The complaint filed before the State Commission was dismissed, and the state order of dismissal of this complaint was confirmed by the National Commission. In this context, I would like to share with you another case wherein I appeared for an orthopedic surgeon. A lady aged about 65 years had a fall and suffered a fracture of hip. She was advised to undergo surgery for replacement of her left hip joint, and the same was performed by my client. After the said surgery, the length of her left leg increased. She filed a complaint before the Honorable State Commission for compensation, alleging that the increase in the length of her left leg was due to negligence on the part of the doctor performing the said surgery, who performed the said surgery. We pointed out to the court from medical literature that limb length discrepancy was a known complication of the surgery for replacement of hip joint. Ultimately, the said complaint filed by the patient was dismissed. We have seen on several occasions that a patient, particularly of advanced age, is admitted in the intensive care unit of a hospital for some ailment. However, few days after the admission, the patient develops serious complications which are totally unrelated to the original ailment of the patient. This is mostly due to nosocomial infection, which is many a times prevalent in intensive care units of the best hospitals in the world. The complications suffered by the patient are usually attributed to the negligence on the part of the doctor or the hospital. But neither the hospital nor the doctor can be held responsible for these complications. Similarly, many a times we hear cases where the patient expires on the operation table before the commencement of the surgery, while anesthesia is being administered to the patient. That is due to the various known complications of anesthesia. One of the major complications of anesthesia is that the patient suddenly goes into cardiac arrest. I appeared for an anesthetist in the case where a girl aged about 28 years was to undergo surgery for appendicitis. It was a planned surgery. And when the anesthetist administered anesthesia, the patient went into cardiac arrest. The anesthetist successfully revived her, but made a grave mistake of administering anesthesia again. She went into cardiac arrest again and could not be revived. In this case, it was held that the doctor was negligent in anesthesia to the patient for the second time, when on the first occasion she had gone into cardiac arrest, and particularly because it was a planned surgery and not an emergency surgery. Then, in certain cases, there are some factors which cannot be noticed by the surgeon unless he operates upon the patient. And during the operation, the surgeon finds that the situation is quite different from the situation which he contemplated. This can also cause serious problems for the patient, but the doctor cannot be said to be negligent. Now, we shall deal with the complaints filed by the consumers against the doctors. I wish to clarify one important aspect of matters relating to medical negligence. The patient should be very careful in filing the complaints, as proving negligence on the part of the doctor is not very easy for the patients. In such complaints, the burden of proof is entirely on the consumer. If the complaint is successful in proving his case, then in that event, the burden would shift to the doctor to prove that whatever he has done is in accordance with standard medical practice. Such complaints are not generally entertained if they are not supported by independent medical evidence. In such cases, the consumer forum can also send the complaints for independent opinion. In this context, one must keep in mind that the line of distinction between negligence and a mishap is very thin. Hence, in every case, a doctor cannot be said to be negligent. In the case of Martin D'Souza versus Mohammed Ishfaq, reported in 2009, Volume 3, Supreme Court Cases, page 1, this Honorable Supreme Court has observed, I quote, "We therefore direct that whenever a complaint is received against a doctor or hospital by the consumer forum or by the criminal court, then before issuing notice to the doctor or hospital against whom the complaint was made, the consumer forum or the criminal court should first refer the matter to a competent doctor or committee of doctors specialized in the field relating to which the medical negligence is attributed. And only after that, the doctor or committee reports that there is a prima facie case of medical negligence, should notice be then issued to the doctor or hospital concerned. This is necessary to avoid harassment to the doctors who may not be ultimately found to be negligent." Unquote. We lawyers should keep all these aspects in mind before advising our client to file a complaint against a doctor. Before filing a complaint against a doctor, the patient must also keep in mind the task that he is undertaking. The patient must do his homework properly. He must have all the requisite documents such as the medical reports, the prescriptions given by the doctor, the instructions given by the doctor, etc. The patient must also try to obtain an independent opinion from another doctor. And this is the most difficult task for the patient. Very few doctors are prepared to give an opinion against their colleagues, or in some cases, they give wrong opinion on account of their professional character. This is likely to put the patient in difficulties during the hearing of the complaint. Here I can give an example of a very prominent doctor in Mumbai who agreed to be examined as an expert witness on behalf of the patient in her complaint before the State Commission, only because the doctor concerned in the said complaint was his rival. However, he could not face the cross-examination by the advocate appearing for the doctor and left the cross-examination halfway. Ultimately, the complainant was left with no choice but to withdraw her complaint before the State Commission. So, independent medical opinion is very important in the matters of medical negligence before the consumer courts. Friends, these are various aspects of matters pertaining to medical negligence. Before I conclude, I must say that the present situation, which has arisen on account of COVID-19, the doctors are working very hard and even to the extent of risking their own lives to save the patients. And I sincerely hope that the doctors are not required to face any legal proceedings on account of any shortcomings in our healthcare system. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. I really appreciate you taking us through the law of medical negligence and the different case laws as well. Before we go ahead, sir, and before we take questions from the viewers, I wanted to ask you, there was a very popular movie about 17, 18 years ago by the name of Munna Bhai MBBS. And in that movie, the protagonist asks whether it was required that the patient, if he is not well, and to quote him, "Marne ki halat mein raha toh form bharne ki zarurat hai kya?" To paraphrase this and extrapolate this a little bit further, if there is an accident, or if, for example, there is a cognizable offense because of which the patient has been brought to a hospital, what is the responsibility of the hospital and the doctors at that time? Because even in movies, it is shown that I'm sure it is wrong, but I would like your perspective on this as well. In the movies, it is shown that the doctor or the hospital will say, you first bring the police, this is a police case, we will not do anything. So could you please elaborate on that?
In this case, it is the duty of the hospital and the doctors to start the treatment immediately. And as I pointed out, as I said earlier, the consent of the patient or his relatives would not be required because it is a case of emergency and the doctrine of necessity would be applicable.
There is also a concern by many doctors that if they get involved in something that might be termed as a cognizable offense or any offense for that matter, because of which that person has been brought for treatment, that they themselves would get involved in those criminal proceedings. What would you like to say to those people who are worried about that?
I don't think doctors will face any problems on that. On the contrary, if the doctors don't give a proper treatment to the patient in such a dire need, that would amount to negligence or professional misconduct on the part of the doctors.
Thank you so much, sir, for taking up that question. We have a question from Mr. Prasad Batavia. He is asking, sir, what is the liability of a medical service aggregator website like Practo if the negligence of the doctor is alleged or proved? Will any liability arise?
Yes. Definitely the liability will arise because they have taken upon themselves the responsibility of giving medical advice to the patient.
Sir, in this situation, the website itself does not provide medical advice, but it's more like a yellow pages and it assists the doctors in setting up appointments and maybe accepting payments. Would there be any liability in that circumstance?
The principle of vicarious liability as far as the hospitals are concerned would be applicable to such sites. In my opinion, the site will be responsible because it is their duty to see that they choose proper doctors, they suggest proper doctors, and to see that proper advice is given to the patients.
All right. Thank you so much, sir. I'll just wait a couple of minutes to see if there are any further questions. Yes, there is one. Mr. Uday Karnik is asking, will a doctor certify the genuineness of a complaint against his colleague?
Usually, no.
I'm sorry?
Usually, the doctors avoid getting into such controversy on a practical level, not on a medical
okay. level. Okay. All right, sir. I believe that is those were the questions that we had for today. I'm sure that if any of the doctors are watching, I'm sure most of their queries would have been satisfied. Or if anybody was planning to file something, I'm sure this would be a good resource for them. So thank you so much for joining us today, Mr. Jaivan. We really appreciate you spending the time and the efforts in giving such an elaborate and lucid representation and exposition on the law of medical negligence and how it ties in with the Consumer Protection Act. So I thank you so much for coming in today. And for the viewers, I really thank you for joining us once again on the webinar of Pro Bono Publico. We hope to bring you more such interesting webinars as time goes by. So thank you again for joining us. And don't forget to like and subscribe down below so you can get some notifications whenever we have our next webinars. So thank you again so much. Stay safe and have a good night. Bye.